What is up, Iwu crew? Today, we will be covering the chilling story of the Dyatlov Pass incident, where 9 hikers met their tragic fate among the snow of the Mountain of the Dead. On January 23rd, 1959, a group of 10 experienced cross-country skiers departed from the Russian city Sverdlovsk, now known as Yekaterinburg, by train. There were 9 students among the group from the Ural Polytechnic Institute and an expedition leader, Igor Dyatlov. They carried enough food and supplies for what was supposed to be a 21-day skiing trip through the Ural Mountains. The train had later arrived in Ivdel, the wind howling down its back, and the group stepped onto the platform in the small Russian town. It was the last leg of their train journey. From here, they took the bus to Vizhe, an even smaller and more remote town, followed by a truck to a logging camp, and then a sled to an abandoned mining camp called North 2. This was the beginning of their trek on skis, but by the time they reached North 2, one of the group members, Yuri Yudin, was ready to turn back. He complained that his sciatica was acting up, and since it had taken them nearly a week to get to North 2, he did not want to push through an additional 2 weeks of the brutal Russian winter to reach their destination. Instead, he turned around with the sled and made his way back to Sverdlovsk. This decision ended up saving his life. The rest of the party pushed ahead. After all, they had all been on these cross-country expeditions before and were eager to catch sight of Kolatsiekl, the Mountain of the Dead. They knew the journey would be challenging. The average daily high for the region was minus 15 degrees Celsius. Though they had just lost a member of their party and were facing down a long, arduous journey, they were in high spirits as they made camp on the bank of the Lozva River. Someone had even brought a mandolin along. They sang, drank, and went to bed early to prepare for the next part of their trek. On the morning of January 31st, the skiers continued to their next stop, the Ospia River. After they set up camp, they made their first attempt at scaling the Mountain of the Dead, but discovered that their packs were too heavy. The following day, they removed their extra supplies from their packs and left them in a cache along their trail. Eventually, they made a new camp on the northern slope of the mountain and planned on making another attempt at summiting in the morning. But in the early hours of February 2nd, something happened that brought the expedition to a sudden halt. 7 men and 2 women were driven from their tent in nothing but their underclothes. Within mere hours, they all succumbed to the harsh winter conditions. When the group missed a rendezvous in Vizhe on February 12th, their friends and family started to get concerned. It wasn't until 9 days later, when there was still no sight of the group, that a search party was deployed. By February 26th, their camp was found. Investigators were puzzled by what they discovered and still are to this day. The search party first discovered the tent that the 9 trekkers shared. It had been ripped to pieces, and half of the tent was buried in the snow. They had expected to find at least one body inside, but it was completely empty. Except for the campers' supplies and shoes, it was clear to them that someone had used a knife to cut their way out of the tent. There was also 9 sets of footprints leading away from the tent. Concerningly, it was clear that all 9 sets were either barefoot or in socks. One person had managed to get on a single boot as they ran for the edge of the nearby forest. The first to be found was Yuri Krivanashenko and Yuri Doroshenko. They were huddled together in a tree well under a large cedar. It was clear that they had tried and failed to make a fire. They had succumbed to the cold in a matter of hours, as they were dressed in only their underwear. Some of the branches of the tree were broken, which searchers believed to indicate that they had tried to climb the tree, possibly to get away from something, get a better vantage point of the camp. they weren't sure. Later on, autopsies showed that the two had scraped their hands trying to climb the tree, and that someone had turned the remains over after their death. The next day, Igor Dyatlov was found about 300 meters from the tree and in the direction of the tent. Then, Zinaida Komogorova was discovered, even further from the tree. On March 5th, they found the fifth member of the party, Rustim Slobodin, covered with snow in between Dyatlov and Kolmogorova. The position and location of their bodies suggested that they were trying to get back to the tent. They too had succumbed to hypothermia. It wasn't until nearly two more months that the other four members were discovered. On May 5th, 1959, the remains of Lyudmila Dubinina, Alexander Kolevitov, Nikola Thibault-Brignon, and Semyon Zolotarov were found buried under 12 feet of snow, 75 meters deeper into the tree line. There were signs that this group had managed to survive longer than the others. Some were wearing clothes that belonged to the deceased members of the trek. They tried to treat their wounds, which for Kolevitov were just a few cuts and bruises. The three others, however, upon autopsy, were said to look as if they had been hit by a car. Dubinina and Zolotaryov had serious fractures in their chests, and Thibault Brugnon's skull had been smashed. And oddly enough, none of these three looked, from the outside, like they had been harmed at all before their death. A few other details to note before we move on to the theories. First off, the final four members of the party had built a shelter out of snow and branches, although none of them had actually been inside the shelter when they died. The last survivors had also collected clothes from their deceased comrades, but most of those clothes were piled beside the shelter, not even used. And lastly, when scanned with a Geiger counter, some of the clothing the hikers had been wearing flared with radioactivity. The investigators' official position was that the tragedy was caused by the mistakes of the leader, Igor Dyatlov. The mistakes include pushing them too hard and setting up camp in a bad spot. Overall, the officials believed that their catastrophe was the result of a natural force they were unable to overcome. The investigation's files were classified. No one really knew what happened on the trek until decades later. After the fall of the Iron Curtain, the Dyatlov Pass incident files were finally declassified, and people began to question the official story, which in itself was incredibly vague. And as more and more details began to come to light, the explanation provided by the authorities at the time made less and less sense. Eventually, an official investigation was reopened by the new Russian government and drew the attention of even more amateur sleuths. These were the questions everyone was trying to answer. Why would nine experienced skiers cut their way out of their own tent and flee into sub-zero temperatures in nothing but their underclothes? Why did some of the remains suffer severe internal damage, but no external distress? Why did Krivonoshenko and Doroshenko try so desperately to climb the cedar? Why did the rest of the party perish out in the open when there was a shelter available? And why were their clothes radioactive? The first theory considered was that of an avalanche. A mass of snow colliding with their tent could explain why they fled and some of their injuries. Experts, however, quickly dismissed this explanation. The slope above their campsite was not steep or tall enough to produce a destructive avalanche of snow. Plus, plenty of pictures from the search party showed the group's gear stuck upright in the snow. It would have been shifted or buried if there had been an avalanche. Other theories suspected a local tribe of natives called the Mansi. Some believed that they had been skilled enough to cover their tracks if they had attacked the trekkers. But there was no reason for the Mansi to go after Dyatlov's party. None of the party's supplies had been stolen either. Plus, dozens of other groups had made the hike before without any interference from the tribe. The third theory posits a military test. Whether intentionally or not, had the Russian military tested a weapon on the group? A rocket or chemical weapon would explain the trauma done to some of the members. The sound of it detonating might have been enough to cause them to rip through their tent and run for the trees. It would also explain why some of their clothes tested positively for radiation. Pictures developed from Semyon Zolotarev's camera seemed to show strange lights in the sky. Proponents of this theory claim that this is evidence of an explosion or even a plane, but could also be explained by water damage to the camera's film. Experts agree that there would likely be more evidence of a blast at the campsite if this had been the case. Other theories include UFOs, Yetis, and even KGB officers. All are attempts to explain the mystery at the heart of this incident. Why did they cut their way out of their tent? What could have triggered so much fear that they ran without even reaching for a coat? There are some aspects of the story that, if taken and examined individually, can be explained. In recent years, a new theory has emerged that can explain why they left the relative safety of their tent, katabatic winds. While the slope of the mountain might not have been steep enough to generate a forceful avalanche, it was sloped enough to create what is sometimes called a gravity wind. A katabatic wind is created when a high-pressure system collides with the sides of a glacial mountain. Wind collects and begins to descend the mountain, picking up even more pressure and speed as it goes. This type of wind is rare, and when it does occur, is not usually that dangerous. However, in the right conditions, it can generate a deadly amount of force. When they pitched their tent parallel to the mountain and using only their skis for tent poles, the wind could have hit their tent and caused hurricane-like conditions. And rather than fumbling with the buttons of the tent flap, they took a knife and sliced through the material. Some members of the party sustained serious injuries, which could have been a result from the wind hitting their tent, and they would not have realized this before they succumbed to hypothermia. And for those who had survived longer, they took shelter in the tree line and then tried to set up a temporary shelter. One of those shelters may have collapsed, fatally injuring the people inside. A similar theory that explains the panic exhibited by the hikers is infrasound. Some postulate that the high winds pushing past the mountain could have created a Karman vortex street. This is a vortex of wind pushing against the summit of the mountain, which could have created infrasound powerful enough to induce a communal panic attack. And the physical injuries could have been caused by falls as they fled. Krivonoshenko and Doroshenko likely tried to take shelter under the cedar, not realizing they had trapped themselves in a tree well. This kind of well occurs when the branches of a tree prevent snow from becoming compacted around the trunk. If someone falls in, it can be nearly impossible to get out before they suffocate. And the radioactivity? The vast majority of the group were students at the Ural Polytechnic Institute, which meant all of them were studying engineering. Kolvatov was even studying nuclear physics. It's not entirely impossible that the radiation was a natural result of their schooling. There are still no clear-cut answers. We may never know exactly what happened that night in February more than 60 years ago, with little tangible evidence and official explanations that only generate more questions. It's easy to go down a rabbit hole of theories. Were they attacked? Could wind either creating infrasound or simply rushing down the slope of the mountain really have caused the skiers to leave their tents and flee into the snow? Nothing seems to fully explain why a group of people so experienced would panic the way they did. Perhaps it was just a series of mistakes fueled by a natural phenomenon, but there is always the possibility that something more nefarious happened to these 9 people. Something that caused even the most rational and experienced among them to abandon all reason, destroy their shelter, and run. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe. A playlist is going to pop up right now with more videos you'll love. See you guys next time.